Well, good afternoon. I'm Rona Free. I'm the provost here at Eastern, and one of the wonderful things about being a provost is that you get to make arrangements for events like this. As many of you know, the last lecture series isn't something unique to Eastern. It's certainly not a novel idea, but it's an idea whose time has come here. We've had the most wonderful faculty at Eastern. I think people are surprised at the faculty members who we have been able to recruit to come to Eastern and to retain, and the exceptional work that faculty members have done here as teachers and as scholars. And so I think it's wonderful to have an opportunity for us to hear the thoughts of faculty members who've made the decision to retire as they are just about to leave us. And this year, we have two faculty members who've decided to leave at the end of this academic year, Dr. Bill Newell and Dr. Neil Williams from the Health and Physical Education Department. But it's just fitting that at a liberal arts college, the very first last lecture should come from someone who's a philosopher, someone from the heart of the liberal arts. So I'm very glad that Bill Newell agreed to give a last lecture. I think it's pretty brave to be the first person to do anything, but I know that he'll set the bar very high. It's wonderful to see family and friends and old colleagues and current colleagues here. This is exactly what we'd hoped for. So I anticipate this being the first of many last lectures in a long series. One of the things that I had hoped to do, and it's worked out, is at each last lecture, one of the retiring faculty members' longtime colleagues will give the introduction. And so today I'm very glad that Hope Fitz, who's been a colleague of Dr. Newell's for many years, has agreed to give the introduction. So, Dr. Fitz.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. It's my honor to be here, and it's with mixed emotions that I'm saying goodbye, because we'll miss you. And we know you're going to be happy. We know you two are just going to have a wonderful life together, as you said, writing and traveling. That's going to be so wonderful. Well, when Rona asked me to do this, I thought, all right, I'm going to think of two categories. Philosopher again. One, the man, and one, the colleague. Now, the man, he's been very humble. He hasn't told us. Now, we've worked together 25 years, quarter of a century. And he never told me about all the things he's done with human rights. Now, you know that I've been involved in peace and human rights here for 17 or 18 years, but I didn't know some of these things about him. And finally, he wrote something, and Rona let me have it. And I want you to know that in his youth, he was what he calls a loyal but dissenting priest, a Catholic priest. And the things he fought for, that a number of us have fought for, have to do with human rights. The civil rights and the racial situation in the South. I don't know how many of you know that he was in that wonderful civil rights march. And Bill, I rarely envy anyone. I wish I could have been with you. I really do. He also fought for things, you that are Catholic, I want you to know that he fought for things that you think are newer. You don't realize that after the encyclical came out in 1968 against birth control and the way it was interpreted, he and about 60 other priests took a very strong stand, and they thought there should be contraception. Now, Bill didn't just do these things. You couldn't kick him out of the Catholic Church, but you could move him to places where he wasn't. You could say, you're through here, whatever university, you're going over there. And this happened repeatedly as he stood for what he believed. And as I look at your faces, I can see so many of you who've been involved with human rights. This is a fighter. And this I did not fully internalize. Now, my colleague, for so long, Bill and I have been working together, and we're thrilled at this point because with the help and the support, particularly of Vice President Rona Free, and also that wonderful woman sitting about four rows back on the left, Professor Nicole Crassus, and we think because President Nunes wanted this, our major in philosophy, the proposal has already passed with the Board of Regents, and it's now ready to go to our curriculum committee and then our Senate. So we are both thrilled. Now, what we did, both of us, over the years, we talked about it, we tried to get one through, but what came to us was, as we talked to one another, Bill, Hope, what is it that we have? And we thought what we had was pretty special, comparative philosophy. So we wanted that and the focus on that, and then we wanted a strong basis in critical thinking and complex reasoning. And I separated the second one out because we have to be able to get out of our own mindsets to be able to hear someone else, to really hear them. Because you can't judge something if you don't understand it. So Bill and I sat together and put this, what our thoughts, I wrote it out, and with the help we've had, we're almost there. So now with that, I turn to my dear colleague, Bill.
I guess now that you know the truth about me, the real truth is I just couldn't get along with people, and so they had to move me. Well, the great French painter of the last century, Georges Rouault, began his work as an artist painting religious subjects in the usual way, but Léon Blois, his work Femme Pauvre, a prophetic work, opened eyes that saw beauty, holiness, and glory in the nameless and homeless wanderer and clown, with a face of humiliated and violated eternal love. Cervantes, Quixote, and Picasso knew this, but the best of them all was Rouault in his Head of a Tragic Clown, 1903. In that one sees that the disfiguring sinful element that wells up from the particular human being's cesspool or from other people's, those who deposit the ordure of their own ugliness on the person portrayed. For what is comic and grotesque is tragic, and the artist's revolt against the disfiguring of men, like Dostoevsky's Prince Mishkin, increasingly becomes compassion. If the clown is the representation and the summing up of all that is humanly grotesque, his portrait is bound imperceptibly and in a continuous process to turn into the image of Christ. Shh, get quiet to hear the voices. We're searching for Jesus now. Jesus is the mask of God, the Father's fool, lived in Dostoevsky, back from the edge of madness. He was shriven by his slow white deaths in Siberia. He emerged in Christ, and his Prince Mishkin was not only Jesus' mask, but his. We are all the masks of God, God's truth, God's words. That truth is our mask, hiding God beneath faces black, white, yellow, brown, hidden beneath the big, the small, the thin, the fat, the male, the female, the sad, the neurotic, the dying, the groundless unsurpassability of the ground walking the earth and not miming anything lest we covet, but inventing God as we go, forgiving, chastened by our limits, and finding in them the God who sees and makes us seen as he walks away before us in the gaps of things, the silences between the beats, the words that we've become, the sacramental masks of our truth, showing yet hiding the best in us, a chiaroscuro, just like God. Jesus and Teilhard de Chardin knew that nothing is precious save what is yourself in others and others in yourself. In heaven, all is but one. Never say matter is accursed. Matter is evil. For one has come who said, life shall arise out of death. This is my body, Jesus. How did he get like that? He was tempted in every way that we are, but without sin. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. He knew that he could not do without the flesh, but he would not taste its fruit unchastely. No, purity does not mean separation from the universe, but an even deeper penetration into it. As Chardin put it, purity is chaste contact with that which is the same in all, from his hymn to the universe. Jesus then, and Jesus today, here in this room. But when the paramount human attitude took on the attitude of abandonment and the experience of the night, wisdom assumed the characteristics of folly, as it does in tragedy. Hans Balthasar, a theologian, then delivers his estimate of modernity's anthropology. And then this night of suffering transcendence reached a deeper level. It became the night of that folly which is sin, and the night of God's wisdom, broken in folly on the cross. At that point, the fool, the buffoon, became straightaway the representative image of man. The fool is continually contradicted, as is obvious, by images of man preoccupied with wisdom, and this is more than ever true once antiquity's and Christianity's concept of the tragic is displaced and obscured by the Platonist Renaissance, the Enlightenment, and classical critique of beauty. Nonetheless, the fool remains the classical image of man in the West in the modern era. From Parzival to Prince Myshkin, the glory that surrounds him is greater and more mysterious than the contours of the figure of the classical idea of man. Dostoevsky mimes. He mimes this with Myshkin, a suffering servant after the fashion of Isaiah's servant. Myshkin played with the hand he was dealt. So did Jesus. Was it Christian transcendence and indifference with Myshkin? Was it what would later be termed Christian indifference and transcendence with Jesus? That's not as ridiculous as it seems. We seek Christian transcendence and indifference because we mime Christ, which is wrong. Mimesis, mimicking, leads to frustrated desire and anger, festering spiritual wounds. We are Christ's, full stop. The supernatural existential is complete, unmerited, the complete unmerited self-donation of Christ's supernatural self to us, and it is offered to all, not just Catholics, not just to believers, but to atheists and agnostics as well. Romans 3, chapter 3, verse 25. There is nothing to be imitated there in the sense that Christ becomes one's there is. The ontological transmuting presence of Christ. One becomes Christ, divinized by God's infusion of God's self in us. Jesus imitated nothing. He became himself as man by the Father's grace and his own efforts at finding himself. Adam had become the homo interruptus, the interrupted man, when he called out his no of disobedience to God's yes to him in creating a supernaturally elevated creature and paradise. And the perfect Adam and Eve were broken because they refused to be themselves, perfected in God, and tried to extend the lease by imitating God. Christ imitated no one. He experienced the interruption between us and the Father in just being a young, growing human being. Not only did he experience the Deus interruptus, the interrupted God of fallen humanity, in which one could just not get there to God. Religion had not made it there to God. Jesus, beloved of God, was discovering his identity, and there he experienced not only himself, but the Father. As he grew, his senses healed, allowing him the joy and innocent experience of the world, even as his fallenness tempted him in other directions. And as he grew, his inner senses healed, and he tasted the Father, heard the Father, saw the Father, touched him. He knew that no one had ever done this, John 6:46, except him, the one sent from the Father and returning to him with more and more regularity through prayer. The Gospels are his self-interpretation, telling us just who the Father is, what he is like. Slowly he realized that he would heal the breach between us and the Father, the interruptus rift caused by Adam and Eve in paradise. Bit by bit, the rift in himself was healing, and when it was done sufficiently, his hour of ministry would be his there is, and he must leave home to give the good news to the poor that the interruption was over. God had returned, and he was the returned God in the flesh. In the flesh, he was delightful. No one was unhappy around him. That was a fatal flaw in Socrates, and Socrates would find it. It led to jealousies and the hatred of the powers and the principalities that run the world with the prince of death, Satan. Jesus suffered God-forsakenness, died for our sins, was the only man to descend into hell and to experience it to pay our debts, and he rose for our life. And for that obedience to the Father, retrieving the Father's likeness in taking on a fallen nature, and by finding himself, healing himself, overcoming his fallenness, he became the original man, able to offer himself on the cross, to experience the God-forsakenness, the experience of hell. And for that love, he was ordained the Christ by the Father. His act of obedient, obediential love is the cosmic song of the Mass, continued forever throughout the world, one act offered and lived ontologically in the Mass forever and for all, not just for Catholics or Christians, for all, everywhere, and for all time. And so he ascended to begin the Church, to continue his redemptive song of love. So what he left us as he ascended, was the clown of the world, Jesus, the apophatic circus of the Church, the mystical body of Christ, whose tendons hold him there and release him from our senses to run the bottomless water of negation, the infinite onion of reality, layered down deep and forever going deeper as each layer sighs itself over to the next darker layer of eternal reality. Yes, he's there when we're there, really there. If a bore is a bore because he can't be present to himself, God removed the boredom of original sin from us boring children of Adam and Eve and left us presences, ours and his, there, and then glanced off to and over there, then almost here in dreams, then here in the poem prayer of Mass and anointing, thanking, interceding, healing the onions of our subconscious, layer after beat up layer until you can't see it or hear it or even feel it. Never could feel it. But the tendons are there, touching, marrying us to him in the only real that is real. If he's real, we aren't. If we're real, he isn't. Meister Eckhart. Whatever is the stuff of God beyond all the stuff that ever was or can be, the stuff of improbable, unfathomable possibility, not a Derridean impossibility, whatever stuff there is now our stuff, now felt mystically in the way it is in the cloud of unknowing, in the real dark night suffered through by those wallowing in their emptiness in nursing homes. But the norm isn't that the cataphatic stuff, the stuff you can touch of consolation without previous cause, it's knowing that the Spirit of Christ is there in that house where a played-out mom takes her ungrateful and unloving daughter and her pup back in when love is the most fey apophatic stuff and only surfaces in inference, the consolation of philosophy. But incarnational theology, sipping deeply from Jesus' poetry and paradoxes, happiness in grief and poverty, the sheer goofiness of the gospel, brings Christ the clown and his circus to town with a booth for food, where he makes our bowels the ark of his new covenant and the booth of the oil of gladness, where not the world's snake oil, but his anoints our suffering and sends the Spirit's hidden tendrils to wipe away the lacrimae rerum, the very tears of things that stalk our nights, and the booth of holy alliances that make relations the trysting place for him in the love warfare of marriage, and the booth of holy teenagers that takes the spiritually infantile past the Disneys of their dreams, giving all the gift to discern the spirits that drive us to know the difference of God and the other. And then the booth of the holy honesty, where the lesser loves are cast off in the absolution of freedom and life, and over to the booth where the clown tosses us in the water of edited anthropology, and last but not least, onto the booth of holy leadership, where the clown lays hands and priests come away able to say the holy eye of absolution and consecration in interceding for others and themselves to offer the clown of Galilee to his Father. Jesus, the clown of Calvary, relieves the world Jesus relieves the world of tragedy. He and the Father are a contrarian God. Jesus inoculated the moral and cultural cholera of the world with his abandonment to being God-forsaken. That act returned religion to the world, a religion lost in Adam Eve's hubris. But that religion will always be foolish to the world, brim full of paradoxes, preaching happiness in grief, a kingdom in poverty, and strength in meekness, and mercy in place of cruelty. We end with the masks of the forlorn behind which irresistible life resides. And the Christ of this religion transmutes the tragedy of the Holocaust into the glory of the Father. The indictment of universal human evil was nailed to the cross, defeating it in its worst masks. Treblinka. There were 6 extermination camps in Poland: Chełmno, Auschwitz, Majdanek, Sobibor, Treblinka. Treblinka was part of the final solution for dealing with the problem of the Jews. It was planned by Reinhard Heydrich. If others were concentration camps where genocide happened, albeit slowly, Treblinka was an extermination camp, designed and operated on an industrial scale as a killing factory. The Jews were herded into cattle cars. The trip from Warsaw took 4 hours. It was horrendous. The cars reeked of chlorine. There was no ventilation and there was no room to move. When the trains arrived at the camp, the doors to the cars were opened, and there to greet them were vacation posters and signs for a ticket office, restaurant, telephone kiosk, along with train schedules and a clock, the arms of which were always at 3 o'clock. All this was painted on the wall, giving the illusion of a transit station for those on their way to a pleasant journey. But there the illusion ended. Jankel Wernick, a survivor, writes, "The Warsaw people were treated with exceptional brutality, the women even more harshly than the men. Women with children were separated from the others, led up to the fires, and after the murderers had had their fill of watching the terror-stricken women and children, they killed them right by the pyre and threw them into the flames. This happened quite frequently. The women fainted from fear, and brutes dragged them to the firefall, half dead. Panic-stricken, the children clung to their mothers. The women begged for mercy, and the eyes closed so as to shut out the grisly scene. But their tormentors only leered at them and kept their victims in agonizing suspense for minutes on end. While one batch of women and children were being killed, others were left standing around waiting for their turn. Time and time again, children were snatched from their mother's arms and tossed into the flames alive, while their tormentors laughed, urging the mothers to be brave and jump into the fire after their children, and mocking the women for being cowards. The estimate of the dead is at least 900,000. Some of the Treblinka guards set the figure above 1 million. Only a few of the guards were ever brought to trial. In the apartment of the camp's last commandant, Kurt Franz, police found a photo album filled with pictures from his time at Treblinka. The photos were taken by SS officers showing them sunbathing, jogging, riding. They pose jauntily. On the cover of the album was written, "Schöne Zeiten," pleasant times. The truth of the victimage mask of the Jews was Christ crucified and risen to life. It was the victims risen to life anonymously by Christ redeeming them. The truth is their mask of Christ, and no evil will cause God to lose anyone. Karl Rahner says, wherever space is really left by parting, by death, by renunciation, by apparent emptiness, provided the emptiness that cannot remain, such as not filled by the world or activity or chatter or the deadly grief of the world, wherever that happens, there God is. The world and the history of the world as a whole will in fact enter into eternal life with God, Rahner. Nothing and no one will be lost. Jesus is salvation and the reconciliation of all with God, 2 Corinthians 5:18 to 19. If I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men to myself, John 12:32. Good night. Sit now or?
You can sit now. Yes. As you know, Dr. Newell has a reputation for being a thought-provoking, challenging, but very encouraging teacher. And his remarks today are obviously evidence of that. So I want to thank you very much for being our first last lecturer. You've set the bar very high. And what we'd like to do now is just have an opportunity for you all to enjoy some refreshments and to discuss with Bill his plans for when he doesn't have to be here to teach early in the mornings until late in the day and can continue his writing. So thank you very much, Bill. Thank you to all of you for coming. Thank you.